Yatzav Ministries, family, friends, and associates. We glorify our Father in heaven, and we sanctify this day on this Sabbath day. I'm your host, Brother Eli, and we welcome you back, those who always faithfully join us on this broadcast. And we pray today in the name of Jesus that everything goes well and we don't get spiritually attacked. But we know the time that we are living in, because we are in the day of the Lord, and you know the enemy has works to be done, and so do we. Let us worship and praise He who is above all things, and we grant and we glorify His Son, who has done amazing things for us and leading us into the way of righteousness, into the kingdom of His Father and our Father. So we welcome you today. And today we got a wonderful and fantastic program for you. We got our worship team right on hand again with some wonderful songs for us, Sister Mariage and Sister Seraphate. And we got the pastor of the ministry, the minister of righteousness, Pastor Man of Issachar, who's got a sermon today which is entitled, Have They All Got It Wrong? Yes, it's a question. Have they all got it wrong? And then we have Sister Mariage. We'll have some two songs of worship, As We Worship You, her first song. And her second song is My Life Is In Your Hands. And Sister Seraphate has two songs, I Give Myself Away, and her second song, Here I Am to Worship. Amazing songs, amazing songs. I'm sure you're going to join them, and let's glorify the heavens. Let the angels join us in heaven. But before we go into our worship songs, let's go before the presence of the Lord. Let's go in a short prayer and asking Him to dwell with us and to forgive our sins and hear unto our prayers as we cry from the earth. For when great tribulation shall come, we want our prayers to be answered and the Spirit of God to dwell with us. So let's go before His presence in reverence. If you can bow your heads and close your eyes, please. O righteous God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we thank You for today. We thank You for Your mercies as endure on this wonderful Sabbath day. We glorify Your name, Father, for the things that You are doing in the spiritual realm that we cannot see, for the mountains that You are moving, for the things You put into formation, for the transformation You're causing in us, and You're calling on us to have faith and believe unto the words that has been said unto us in the scriptures. For if we believe unto You, Father, these things will come to pass. And we believe unto You as we believe in what You did for us. For You save us by grace through Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. So we glorify Your name. We ask that You continue blessing each and every one at the sound of my voice, and every members of our families, and all our trials and tribulations that we're going through eternally, whether it's financially, whether it's emotionally, or in each and every way our trials come before us. Help us to endure. Give us the faith of Abraham. Give us the patience of Job. Oh, Father, and let us try and walk in righteousness and holiness as Your Son did, Yeshua Mashiach. And let us praise and glorify Your name even through the midst of all things, that we may be, that it may be a sign for those that walk in sinfully could see. We glorify Your name in every season that is upon us. Oh, Father of mercies, we glorify Your name. We thank You for Beatzab Ministries. We ask that You bless this service today, and let everyone that receive this sermon and service today will seek after You, and most importantly, repent and change their life, for the time is at hand, for Your kingdom is at hand. We ask that You bless our pastor, Man of Issachar, and continue providing him with these sermons that he can deliver unto the world. We pray for each and everyone. We pray for the nation. We pray for the leader of this country, those that lead in this country. We pray that they may lead in righteousness and in holiness. For we know we don't want to suffer the sins of those that are leading us into corruption. But Heavenly Father, in the midst of all the chaos, You are able, and Your hands are long and strong enough to deliver us from all the peril. And we ask this in the mighty name of Yeshua Mashiach, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And we say amen, 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 amen. We glorify our Father above. Without further ado, we're going to move into the worship song. Let's keep that door in heaven open. And as we become before His holy throne in worship, we welcome Yeshua into our presence. For where two or three are gathered, there is in our midst. And we know our Lord and Savior is dwelling with us. We know that Abiathar Ministries and you as well, wherever you are, for He's omnipotent and He can dwell amongst all of us. Yes, even in the comforts of our home. Without further ado, Sister Maria, take it away with your first song.
Thank you very much, Brother Eli. Our first song today will be As We Worship You. The congregation would like to join and worship the Lord.
As we worship You, let all the world come and see how the mercy we receive from You can set them free. As we worship You, let all this joy that fills our hearts bring a hunger and a hope to those who stray so far. As we bow in adoration and stand in reverent awe, show Your majesty and glory as Your anointing fall. As we declare Your name, Lord Jesus, as the only name who saves, may the power of Your salvation fill each heart, we pray.
Oh, we welcome you here.
He's the only one who's able to save us. Amen.
No matter what you're going through, I know that you can stand. For your life is in His hands. Listen.
You don't have to worry. You don't have to be afraid. Joy comes in the morning, troubles they don't last always. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, comes in the morning,
troubles they don't last
always. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your hands and say, oh, I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in your hands. My life is in your hands.
my life in your hands. And now we move on to Sister Sarah Faith. Thank you.
Praise God! Good morning, good morning, good morning. Or good afternoon, good afternoon, good afternoon. Or good evening, good evening, good evening. Hallelujah. Thank you so much, Sister Marriott. Our first praise is going to be, I give myself away.
Give myself away.
Praise God, thank you. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. Here I am, here I stand. God, my life is in your hand. Lord, I'm longing to see your desires revealed in me. I give myself away. I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away. I give myself to you. Oh, my life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you, Father. You are great. My life is not my own. To you I belong. There's no other God, there's no other God but you. Hallelujah. My life is not my own. To you I belong. Oh, always. I give myself to you. No other God will do. My life is not my own. To you I'm glad that I belong. I give myself to you. Hallelujah, my life as a living sacrifice, Father. For you deserve it all. You deserve all the glory, honor, and praise. I gave myself to you. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give my heart to you. Praise God! Hallelujah, glory, 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 praise God, mwah. Hallelujah. Now our second praise is going to be, here I am to worship, hallelujah. And that's what we are here to do, worship God and praise Him, praise God.
Open my eyes, let me see the beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say, God, King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth God created, all for love's sake became King. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my King, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I
Hallelujah, praise God. No, Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. You are amazing. I love you so, 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 so much. Mwah. And Daddy in heaven, I love you so, 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 so much. Mwah. Praise God. You are the best ever. Hallelujah. What a privilege and an honor and a praise. The privilege and an honor and a glory to be able to praise our Father and our King. Now back over to you, Brother Eli.
Thank you, Sister Seraphim. Thank you very much for wonderful songs of worship. And Sister Mariage, for your great efforts today, we glorify the heaven above. We thank God for your lives, and we thank God that you have endured and continue representing Bielsa Ministries. We are trying to lead like the children of the light. So we glorify God in heaven for the wonderful songs of worship. We know He's receiving those songs of praises. Oh, and now we're going to move into the sermon. Yes, by our minister of righteousness, Pastor Man of Issachar. And the sermon is entitled today, Have They All Got It Wrong? Take it away, Pastor Man of Issachar. Thank you, Pastor Man of Issachar. Well-deliberated message today and sermon. We glorify our Father in heaven, and we always ask that our Lord and Savior, Yeshua Mashiach, remains in our presence. And we ask that everyone stays steadfast on this journey. It's going to get turbulent. It's going to get rocky. It's going to get rough. But we need to endure and remain on that narrow path. We ask that the Lord bless you in each and every way and your family, and continue letting you lead this ministry for righteousness and holiness. And we thank each and everyone for joining us today. We glorify God for your life, and we ask that if you have not chosen to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it is a good time to do that. And if you are, if there's something that you know that you're doing wrong, I ask that you repent and turn away from it, because the kingdom of God is at hand. Until next time, we all love you here at Bielsa Ministries. May the good Lord bless you. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Eli, and welcome once again, one and all Bielsa Ministries friends, families, and associates. We give God thanks that He has brought us here together as a family to come together and share His word, the bread of life. We thank God for all of you here, and we pray always that He keep you in under His blessing and covering, that He may protect you from all the enemy. We thank God for you, and we know that God has kept you from the plans of the enemy that was there to destroy or break you down. But He has kept you for another week. His mercies, which are new every morning, has brought us here. We will rejoice in this holy Sabbath day that God has made. Let our heart be glad in it. May He forgive us of our iniquities and our sins, and may He keep us as the apple of His eyes. O child of God, let's bow our head and go before the throne of grace as we acknowledge Christ amongst us, our Lord and Savior. And you know that He's with us. And therefore, let us bow our heads in reverence of our Lord and our God, Jehovah. Blessed be His name. O righteous God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, we come not by our own self, our own strength, but we come in the strength of Yeshua HaMashiach, your only begotten Son, Him who you raised from the grave on the third day. You brought Him back from the dead, and you made Him kings of kings and Lord of lords. He ruled over all. We believe your word that He is risen. Therefore, we have hope in your word, and we have trusted in your word, that through His sacrificial offering, just like the lambs that were offered at the tabernacle, our sins are blotted out. And we don't only want our sins to be blotted out, but we want a new heart to walk in holiness and righteousness, that we may be pleasing in your sight. always be pleasing in your sight. We want a heart that do all things to your will, Father. We want a new heart, because our Lord and Savior says, out of the heart flows the issues of life which defile it, the body. And we don't want nothing coming from our hearts that defile it, our body, or spot it, our garments. Therefore, we ask, O righteous Father, renew a right spirit in all of us, and a new heart, just like David asked for a new heart. So we do. And according to your covenant that you made, the second covenant, where you said you put your law in our hearts and give us a new heart, not a heart of stone, but a heart of flesh, that we may do the things that please you. So we ask you to fulfill your word in our lives. We pray, righteous God, that our eyes may be open for the times that we are living in, and that this word is based on a question, that it may cause people to consider what they have learned, and cause people to consider the time they're in. More important, may it cause them to change their ways for the time they're in. For the words that we speak is your word, and your word are life. And they change and cause transformation in people. We are in the last days, and your word says, all who call upon your name and the name of your son in these days shall be saved. And we are calling, Father. We are calling on you, Jehovah. We are calling on your son. We are believing you for salvation. For salvation and transformation and restoration to fellowship with anyone that has fallen out of fellowship with you. We are believing all this on this Holy Sabbath day. We are believing it because you are good, and there's none good like unto you. We fall upon your mercies, and we ask for more grace. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pray. Amen. Amen. So today, this sermon is more of a question, and it's hoping to ignite questions. So what it's about is about things that we have been taught. And so some of the questions that is being posed today, all of us have searched up, including me. Because what we need to do is make sure that what we have been taught is correct, especially in these days when we were forewarned, be not deceived. In these last days, the first teaching when Jesus was giving the apostles then the signs of his coming is, be not deceived. And so, because that is the trust of the warning from our Christ, we want to make sure that what we have learned over the years is correct and biblically sound. And also, I understand that some of the things that we're going to go is really deep for new beginners, you know, babes in Christ. But I'd have asked them to bear with us, because we understand that every word of God is good. Every word of God. And though you might not understand fully what's been said today, it will sow into your heart for the day when you come to that level, will bring the understanding. Because the seed that we are sowing is the word of God, and it always prosper to where it's sent. And we are sending it into your hearts and mind today, that we hope that at the end of this sermon, everybody will have to consider the times that we are living in. That's the trust of this. We want to waken you up to the times that you are living in. We want to shift in you an urgency, an urgency to prepare for the coming of our Lord and Savior. And I understand that many people throughout the eons has been proclaiming that Jesus Christ is coming. People has even gone into sects where they would go into community by themselves, and some of them kill themselves, mass suicide. Some people sell their house, all kind of things that they did in preparation for the coming of the Lord. all these things has happened. False prophets has caused people to lose their house, their land, their lives. They have. It's true, it's documented, and it cannot be taken back. But we are not asking you to join a sect. We are not asking you to sell your house. We are not asking you to do anything otherwise. Repent, turn, keep God's commandments, and live holy. That's all we're asking you to do. You don't have to come and be a part of ministries to do this. You can do it at your church, at your home, wherever you are. So we are not seeking anything but to impart knowledge which may guide you in the times that we're living in. So because this sermon is mostly question based, some of the answers are not readily available today. But I'm seeking God's face for the answers, because understanding is what we want. But the questions are put in a way to ask, what have I been learned or been taught? Is it the correct thing? That's what we want to find out. What we have been taught, is it the correct thing? Now, this sermon arises from being prodded by a brethren about the end times, and we were discussing it, and I didn't know what I was gonna do this morning. So as we discussing it, sometimes God bring me sermons via something come in my heart, or sometimes people prod me, and I had nothing, I can't get away from it, I have to come and face it. And this is what happened today. I have to come and face it. So I'm here to face the prodding. Now, as everybody should know, or if you don't know, I'll tell you that Jesus Christ told me that we're in the day of the Lord. In my ears, he spoke to me, told me that we are in the day of the Lord. And the day of the Lord is a time when God brings judgment on the world. It's a time when Jesus Christ returned back with his Father. It's a time of war. And this is the dispute or the discussion that we had with the guy that was prodding me. He was saying, how do I know that Jesus Christ is coming back in time of war? Ain't there many other things have to be fulfilled? And so, because I understand all the teaching that he was talking about, I went and researched, and I said, you know what? Let's put this to the people, and you, the viewer. Have we been taught the correct thing? Is Jesus Christ coming back in a time of war or not? Because I truly understand that we're going to third world war, and it's in our lifetime, very soon. I truly understand that Jesus is coming back. Don't know the day, don't know the hour, but I do know we're in the season. We're in the season. There's no doubt about it. We are in the season. There's many things that have been fulfilled, which when people were before saying that Jesus was coming, were not yet fulfilled, but they're all fulfilled now. Israel is back in the land, and some other more important things has happened. But most important, Israel is back in the land, because Jesus would not come back until Israel was back in the land so they could receive the kingdom promised to them in Acts chapter 1 verse 6. So that's the first thing we have to know. So what we're doing here, for those who don't understand, we are trying to look at the end times, which is the last days, the coming before the coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and our Father, our God. Before they come, they give us signs that we should look as believers. And so many people has teach different things over the eons, over the decades. And so what we're doing is, as a family, today, as a family, we are seeing if what we've been taught is correct. So, there's not many revelation today, more of a questionnaire. And the question is for put into your heart as a viewer to go and search it out. So, one of the things, the signs that Jesus gave us which has been fulfilled and should point us very strongly to his coming, is found in Luke 20:21 to 26. Luke 21 to 26. Sorry about that. Yeah. It's found in Luke 21 to 26. So here we go. So what we're going to read is the scriptures, and then we're going to ask the question, because we want to know, are we closer to Jesus coming? Are we at the doors? Are we at the doors? So here's the first proof, which the scripture tells us that we are at the doors of his coming. And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed about with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. When you shall see Jerusalem compassed about with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. So the first thing Jesus, one of the things that Jesus said in Luke is, when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, which is the Roman army, know that the desolation of Jerusalem, the country Israel, is now nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and them which are in the midst of it depart out. Let not them which are in the country therein enter into, for these be the day of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck in those days, for these are days of great distress in the land, and wrath upon the people. Wrath upon the people, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and distress of nation upon the earth with perplexity, and the sea and the wave roaring. Men's hearts shall fail them for the fear of looking after those things which are coming upon the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall ye see the sign of the Son of Man coming in the clouds with power and glory. And when you see these things, when you see these things, look up, for your redemption draw it nigh. Your redemption draw it nigh. So the teaching that we have in Mark chapter 13 verse 14, we're talking about the abomination of this desolation, the abomination that caused it desolation. It's Mark chapter 13 verse 14. But when ye shall see the abomination spoken of by Daniel standing in the place where it ought not, let him read it, understand. Then let them be in Judea, flee to the mountains. Let them be in Judea, flee to the mountains. So the teaching that we have is that this is when somebody in the end times going to the temple and place some statue or something or whatever that caused abomination in the temple, or the man of sin going to the temple. So this is what the teaching is of this. This is what most people have been taught, and all those who know the end times theory would actually know what I'm talking about. And if you never know about the end time theory, the teaching is that in the last days, which I'm trying to tell you that we're in, they'll go into the temple. They're going to build back the temple that's in Jerusalem. They're going to build back the temple in Jerusalem, and there, the Antichrist is going to go in there and put the abomination that caused desolation. But what question I'm asking, have those people who teach this doctrine, have they got it wrong? Have they all got it wrong? Because as you just see, it says, but when ye shall see the abomination that caused desolation, spoken of by Daniel the prophet, standing in the place where it ought not. So it's standing where it's not supposed to stand. Let them that read it understand. Let them which be in Judea flee to the mountains. And we just read Luke, where it says, when it's Jerusalem's surrounded by armies, know that the desolation is nigh. And so what's happening is, when they were surrounded by the army, there were Jewish defenders trying to defend the temple and defend everything. And so what did have on one side, the west side or the north side, there were Jewish soldiers defending the temple, and on the other side, inside the temple ground, were Roman soldiers fighting, and they were fighting each other on the temple. That was an abomination to God. And I'm saying, is this not the abomination that caused desolation, which the Bible talking about? Because the Bible declares that the first desolation to Jerusalem was when Jerusalem was taken to Babylon, where the land was desolate for 70 years. Now, here we have again, the abomination that caused desolation, which shall never be again, is when Rome destroyed Jerusalem and caused it to be desolate for over 2,000 years, maybe 10% of the population was there. And when Mark Twain, the writer Mark Twain, went there in 1800, he says, he never see such a desolate place. Never see such a desolate place. So my question is the teaching that this is going to happen in the future correct? Because the Bible says Jerusalem, once it go back into the Israel, once it go back into the land, shall never be moved again. So how can the land ever going to be desolate anymore? Is the teaching correct? My charge to you is go and search it out. Because if you are looking for something to happen that's already happened, you have been deceived and you will be caught unawares. So that is what that scripture is there for, to cause your heart to search and see, really, is this the truth that I've been taught? Or have they all made an error who have taught this doctrine or this teaching? Again, we want to go to Matthew, and this is about the rapture, that there's no rapture before Jesus coming. It's just a little to show that there's no rapture before Jesus coming. But more importantly, it's to show that Jesus come back in or after a war. In a war or after a war. In a war, after war. Remember, Jesus told me that we're going to Third World War. Well, he told me that we're in the day of the Lord, which the Bible says the day of the Lord is when God brings the sword of the Lord from one end of the earth to the other end of the earth in judgment. So, and it's a day of war. So, as I said, Jesus said, this is the time he come back in. And he said, we are at the doors. He said, this is early in the morning. Speaking of the day of the Lord, and that was 10 years ago. So my question to you now, this teaching that we're going to be raptured, have the people them got it right? Have they got it right? Because we got to be sure. Because if you have been taught from a child upwards that you will not be in the tribulation and you will be raptured, if you have been taught that, you have been set up to fail if there's no rapture. you have been set up to fail. It might be a good church, it might be something that it seems good, but at the end of the day, when the tribulation come and no rapture come and the enemy starts to speak in your ears, where is your God? Where is he not taking you? You're going to feel like you're failing your God. You're going to feel like, oh, why is this something my God has forsaken me? And all the negative thoughts will start to pour into your heart and you will buckle. You will buckle under that pressure and you will lose your faith in God because the erroneous teaching that you would be raptured before the tribulation. But if you, as they will say, prepare to go through the tribulation, and there is no tribulation and you are raptured, then it's all well and good. You rejoice. But it's better to prepare than fail to prepare. It's better to prepare than fail to prepare. We're going to Matthew 24, verse 28 to 31. Matthew 24, verse 28 to 31. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagle be gathered. So Jesus says, just prior to that, they shall say, if they say, the Son of Man is in the desert or is in the secret chambers, go not after them. For as the lightning cometh from the east to the west, so shall the Son of the Man appear and be. And wherever the carcass is, there will the eagle be gathered. So he's telling you, say, where there is the battle, the war, the dead man, the carcasses, there he will be, because he'll be battling. He's coming to fight. He's not coming back as a lamb no more. He's coming back as a conquering lion. So if he's coming back in war, and Jesus told me that we are going to third world war, and this is the day of the Lord, we better be prepared, and prepare than fail to prepare. And how you prepare? Repent and turn and do righteousness and holiness. It's the fundamental basis of Christianity. Repent, turn and do righteousness, and do the things that please God. Then it says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun shall be darkened and the moon shall not give her light. The stars from heaven shall fall and the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. So it says, after the tribulation, he comes. After the tribulation, he comes. So anybody teaching about secret rapture and the third coming of Christ, they're preparing you to fail. There is no secret rapture. There is no secret rapture. According to the scriptures, after the tribulation of those days, after, then the Son of Man will come, and he shall send his angel with a sound of a trumpet. Thessalonians chapter 2, the Lord shall ascend, and with the voice of a trumpet, and the dead in Christ shall arise first. You know what it is? After the tribulation. Again, after the tribulation. So, my brethren and sisters, it's time to change your mind and prepare to go through the tribulation, that you may be able to stand, knowing that your God loves you through the trials and through the tribulation, and he's not forsaking you. Even if you have to die, he's not forsaking you. But if you're not prepared to change, you're preparing to fail. You will be preparing to fail if you're not prepared to change. So, I'm just going through the questions, asking, have the people I'm taught this about the rapture, have they got it wrong? Have those people all got it wrong? Now, I'm just going through the scriptures again, just looking for things about the end times and asking the question, putting it in your heart. Now, there's a very controversial one is in Revelation chapter 20, where it says Satan, after he's been bound for 1,000 years, is loose and he goes and get a nation, guess what? To battle again. Jesus come in war, Satan goes out to get a nation to battle. And this is very powerful consistency in the Bible that I'm going to bring some more where it comes to battle, and you'll see that Jesus' word that he told me is true. He's coming, third world war, and he's coming in the war. You ready or not? Here he comes. So let's go. And it says, and when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loosed out of his prison and shall go out and deceive the nation which are in the four quarters of the earth. Which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog, and gather them unto battle, the numbers whom as the sand of the sea. So the first thing that Satan do when he's released from the pit, he's released from the bottomless pit, the first thing he does is to gather nation to battle. To battle. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the camp of the saints about the beloved city, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them. And the devil that deceived them were cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast, the beasts, and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And this is the controversial part for me personally. This is the controversial part for me. Where Satan, we have been taught, and many doctrines have been taught that Satan, well, the false prophet and the beast is cast into the lake of fire 1,000 years before Satan. And then now Satan is cast in there later on. That is what been taught. But this is not sitting well with me. I just can't put my finger on it, but there's something not right with the scriptures, not the scriptures itself, with the understanding of the scriptures, because Satan is loose and goes to war. You're going to find that the false prophet and the beast is taken in war, and you're going to find other things which you have to wonder, are we understanding the scriptures right? Because if Satan is destroyed and then in a war, and then after that New Jerusalem land, then one thing it tells you, the day of the Lord, war, then Jerusalem, Jesus come. The consistency of that is just consistent, cannot be denied by no viewer, that we're going to see that every time you see Jesus come, the New Jerusalem is after a war, like now, and it's when the battle has been completed, then you see New Jerusalem come. So the war is a consistent theme of the time of the coming of Christ. And I'm telling you, we're going to Third World War. You need to shape up. So, but the other thing that about this scripture is, why would God do all his judgment, and then after he done all his judgment, bind Satan, cast the two prophets them into the lake of fire, then bind Satan in a pit, and then loose him to fight another war? It doesn't make sense. Something is wrong. Some understanding is wrong, and that's what I want to search out, and I'm seeking God about it, because I definitely know that something is wrong. I haven't put my finger on it yet, but something is wrong. something is wrong with the understanding. And this, I truly believe they have not got this one right. They have not got this one right. So here is the reason I'm putting to you they haven't got this one right. So the beast, the false prophet, and the dragon or Satan are one in the scriptures. They all work together. You see them in you see it in Revelation 13. It's the dragon gave the power unto Rome and the false prophet. Yes, and the false prophet then tell to make an image of the dragon or the Rome. There's a three of them working together in there. And then you see them in the scriptures, they're working together in where we're going to read now. They're working together. So they're always working together, but suddenly, working together all the time, then suddenly one is put away for 1,000 years, which happened. But the point is, when was he put away? Before the end times? Or was he put away after the end times and then God bring him out? I'm purposing my heart. It had to be before the end times. That 1,000 years had to take a place before the end times, and the three of them get at the end times, and the battle that you see from different point of view is what we are seeing in the scriptures. But I haven't got it together yet. God hasn't shown me full understanding yet, and I'm waiting on the Lord. But those who wait upon the Lord shall mount up with wings of eagle. So we are going to wait on him. I will not be weary when I'm running with the Lord. And when I walk, I shall not faint. I will wait on him. He will give the understanding. Because this is the day of the Lord. It shall come forth. But I just want you also to seek God in it. And to seek God face on it. So let's go to we want to go to Revelation chapter 16, verse 1 to 16. The reason I'm taking all the scriptures here is because it shows you this is the last plagues of the Lord. This is the last plagues. So this is, you have the first, you have the on this breaking of the seals, the seven seals. Then you have the seven trumpets. And this is what you call the wrath of God, the seven last plagues. And here at the seven last plagues, you still have the beasts and the false prophets. Let's go. And I heard a great voice out of the temple saying to the seven angels, go your way and pour out your vials of the wrath of God upon the earth. And the first went and poured his vials upon the earth. And there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the man which had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worship his image. And the second poured out his vial yet upon the sea, and it became blood of a dead man, and every living soul in the sea died. And the third poured out his vial upon the fountains of the water, and they became blood. And I heard the angels of the water say, thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and was and shall be, because thou hast judged us. For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, for thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy. And I heard another out of the altar say, even so, Lord God Almighty, true and righteous are thy judgment. And the fourth angel poured his vial upon the sun, and power was given him to scorch man with fire. And men were scorched with great heat and blaspheme the name of God, which had power over this plague, and they repent not to give him glory. And so even now, before these things happen, just as we're going into these things, nobody wants to repent. Nobody fear God. Nobody have the faith to believe that God will forgive them of their mercy, their sins, and cleanse them of their unrighteousness if they would just fall down and give him glory and repent. But everybody is stiff-necked nowadays and leaning to their own way and their own understanding. What is the basic thing as a Christian we should do, no matter what denomination we are from or what we believe, the basic thing we should do is be falling before our God and repenting of our sins and turning away from them. That's the basic thing we should be doing. But As it said, in these days, nobody will want to do it. And the fifth angel poured his vials upon the seat of the beast. So here, the beast is here. And it is the fifth angel. The fifth. There are two more plagues to go. And the beast is here. Is God pouring out all his judgment and then going to tie up Satan for 1,000 years and lose him back again to fight something like this again? Is this really what we're being taught? Is that what we are understanding from the scriptures? Or have something we miss? Have we missed something? I just can't put my finger on it, so I can't say outright. But the knowledge of God and the wisdom of God say that it's not so. So we have to search the scriptures and plead before God to get this understanding. But I know, because the day that we're in, the revelation shall come to those who seek. Because it says, seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open. So I'll be knocking and I will be seeking, because I know my God, who is God, reveal all secrets, and to him all knowledge is with. So his word, he knows what this is about. And because we're this time, I know that we shall have the revelation in due season if we seek God's face. And the fifth angel poured his vial upon the seat of the beast, and his kingdom was full of darkness, and then God did gnash their teeth for pain, and blaspheme God of heaven because of their pain and their sores, and repent not of their deeds. Again, the consistent theme of the end days, lack of repentance. Lack of repentance. And the sixth angel poured his vial on the great river Euphrates, and there it was dried up to make way for the kings of the east might be prepared. And I saw three unclean spirits coming out from the mouth of the dragon, the mouth of the beast, and the mouth of the false prophet. This is after the sixth vial has been poured out. And they are gathered in for what? The battle of the great day of the Lord. And this scripture here, what we're reading, for their spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth and of the whole world to gather them unto the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Behold, Jesus said, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garment, lest he walk naked and they see shame. And they were gathered into a place called, in Hebrew tongue, Armageddon. Now, not only Jesus told me in the day of the Lord, I had a vision about this exact scriptures telling me that we are in the day of the Lord, which I tell everybody else. And also the other day, I was just doing another video, and after reading the scriptures, the things that happened in the vision actually happened straight away. So I would know we are close, very close to this manifestation of this war. And again, the theme continued to be, Jesus Christ is coming in the war. And we should be preparing ourselves. It's a consistent theme in the scriptures. And I just want to know, is the teaching that the 1,000 years and the false prophets and the beast is cast into the lake of fire for 1,000 years before Satan, is that teaching right or is it wrong? Because they're here at the end times and going to battle just like Satan when he's loose, he's coming to battle. I believe, we haven't put our finger on it right, I believe that there's a misunderstanding in scripture. And everyone who is a godly and have a heart after God will seek God in this matter. Because we have to be prepared. The first warning Jesus gave us, be not deceived. Now, one of the end time teaching is that we're under grace, which we are, And therefore, since we're under grace, we don't need to do nothing else. Whatever sins we're going to do, Jesus' blood has covered it. I know for a fact that they that teach those things are wrong. That one I don't have to ask. I'm telling you, they are wrong. They're wrong. We are saved by grace, but we have to do good works. Otherwise, we become a backslider and get destroyed. Revelation chapter 14, verse 10 to 11. Revelation chapter 14, verse 10 to 11. This is after the 144,000 land on a mount, Olive. And after the land, this is where they came back to Jesus, and they're coming back to battle. They're coming back to war. They're not coming back to what preach the gospel as some people teach. They're coming back to battle. The scriptures say they're coming back to battle, not to preach the gospel. They're coming back to war. They're called faithful and true. These are the ones that are faithful and true that walk with Jesus. And they're coming back to war. They're coming back to battle. And I would tell people, and they might not want to believe it because they don't understand the time that we're living in, and not taking the scriptures back into the time that it was written, where the system and the people we live in a matriarchal system. That means it was male orientated. That means when it said 144,000 men, it mean men, no woman. It doesn't mean woman, it mean men, because they were male orientated society. So the scriptures were male orientated also. So not just that, God also used man for priesthood. Woman, God used as prophetess. God used woman as prophetess and all that. But when it comes to the priesthood, it was always men. Always men. So I know that it might be inflammatory statement nowadays, but just telling the truth. That's what we're here to do, is tell the truth. So he says, the same shall drink of the blood of, if anybody worship the beast, he said, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which poured out without mixture. Let me just see if I missed, yes. Without mixture. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angel and in the presence of Lamb. And the smoke of their torments ascend up forever and ever. They have no rest day and night, who worship the beast or his image, or who receive it his mark of his name. And we're continuing, Revelation 14, 12 to 13. Revelation 14, 12 to 13. This is the point, as believers, we should focus on. Because this is being said to us after Jesus Christ is risen. This is being said to us after Jesus Christ is landed on Mount Olive, and he's just giving us, telling us back in the past what we should be doing, that when we reach this day, or we come to this day, we'll be ready, and that our garment won't be soiled. This is what it says to us, all believers who are true, whose heart is for God. It says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus Christ. You know, the scriptures separate them, the commandment of God, the faith of Jesus Christ. And I heard a voice saying unto me, right, blessed are they which die in the name of the Lord from henceforth. Yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, and their works do follow them. So your works are going to be checked at the end of the day. Did you do good after believing on Christ? Did you turn and do righteousness? Did you turn and do good to the poor? Did you do good things? Or did you believe on Jesus Christ and continue to live in sin and expect to be saved? When our salvation, for salvation, I keep saying, we are saved by the blood. Every one of us who believe on Christ is saved by the blood. but we are saved unto good works. That's what we have to do, the good works. Therefore, it says, keep God's commandments and keep the faith of Christ. And it's saying after Jesus was resurrected, seated at the right hand of God. So it's very, very, very focused on us that we should live right and holy as a child of God. And I'm here again asking all these questions because I'm trying to stir up people's hearts to understand the time they're living in. To understand the time you're living in. In Matthew 24, Jesus said he will, when he comes back, he will appear where the carcass is. Remember we read that earlier on. And so I wanted to link it to these scriptures in Revelation 19. Revelation 19, I wanted to link it to from 16 to 21 we're going to read. Revelation 19, 16 to 21. And I really wanted to hear what Jesus says, what's happening in the scene that's happening in this scene. And see what Jesus come back as. So that we have a full understanding and will not be deceived by people. Because we have to know how Jesus come back. Because Jesus forewarned us that many false prophets will arise, saying I'm anointed or saying I'm a Christ. And we also be forewarned that Satan appear as an angel of light. So, is you know something that's really on my heart, is really bothering me. It's really, really bothering me and I can't shake it. Many people claim they have seen Jesus all over the world. Always by himself. And he always looked like that image created by man. Image created by man. Revelation 13 says, the beast created an image, and he had power to give image life unto the image, that the image should speak. And whoever shall not worship the image shall be put to death. I'm fearing in these last days. I hope I'm wrong. But I'm fearing. How can Jesus be the image created by man? And all of us, not all of us, not BHSAP Ministries, not those at BHSAP Ministries, they keep sharing this image, reinforcing it into your mind, reinforce it in your heart. So when you dream, you're gonna see that image. So the way to break it is to cast that image away from you. Keep the commandments of God. Thou shalt not have any image of anything in earth, in heaven, or under the earth. For I, the Lord thy God, is a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children of the third and fourth generation, but showing love and mercy to those who love me and keep my commandments. So, it's okay going keeping the Sabbath day, but having the image in your book is foolishness. You don't keep the Sabbath day because to break one is to break all. To break one is to break all. So it's just a deception. Let's go. We're going to read it. And he had on his vesture and on his tie a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come gather yourself unto the supper of the great God, that he may eat the flesh of kings and the flesh of captains and the flesh of mighty men and the flesh of horses and them that sit upon the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beasts and the kings of the earth and their army gathered together to make war that him that sit upon the horse and against his army. I saw the beast. The beast is still there. and the kings of the earth and gather together. Satan lead out the people then. Gather together to make war against Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. But he is kings of kings and he's lords of lords. Therefore, they will never ever be able to defeat him. He's going to destroy them all. Destroy them all. Let them come. They are just coming for the supper, and they are the supper. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet who worked miracles before him. And the beast and the false prophet fighting Jesus in the last days. Are you sure we got Revelation 20 right? One more time. Have they been teaching it to us right? The next thing, Jesus tell me, this is the day of the Lord. We're going to third world war, and it's coming in this time. Every scripture that we read today points, he's coming in the war. We're going to third world war. He's coming. Things are about to take a big change in the next 4 months, 5 months to 6 months. From November to January, the world is going supercharged, forward into the end time. We're going to take off. Watch and see. These boats were cast alive into the lake of burning fire with brimstone, and a remnant was slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all were fowls filled with their flesh. So the questions, what I'm saying today is, Jesus is coming after the time of the Gentiles that was fulfilled in 1967 when Jerusalem got full control of Israel for the first time. The Jewish people, the times of the Gentiles came to an end. Jesus is coming immediately after those. After that, he said in Luke, just the sun and the moon, and we see signs of the sun and the moon, so much moon turning blood eclipse. So much eclipse happening, one after the other, bam, bam, bam. We're like, what's going on? All these eclipse, 5 eclipses in 1 year, all different eclipses, the sun eclipse, the moon eclipse, signs in heaven, as Jesus said would happen. He's coming soon. Yes? So we are at the doors. We're just going into war, and that's it. New kingdom come. Jesus is here. Prepare yourself. People say, don't tell people that. Because you don't know the time or the hour. No, I don't know the time or the hour, but I know the season. We are in it. Don't tell people that you're scaring them. I'm scaring them to do righteousness and holiness. Paul said, if you pull them up by the fire, that means by scaring them, you pull them up to the fire by fear, they're still safe. The point is, you turn because you just fear that Jesus is coming, you still will be safe. There's no rule how to be saved. The rule is repent and change. That's it. Why you repent is not a problem. As long as you repent, that's the problem. Jesus come in the war to fight with the 144,000. So no man can come and say he's Jesus unless he has 144,000 angels with him. No man can come and no spirit can come and say he's Jesus unless he has 144,000 with him. The scriptures clearly tell us if we'd follow it. Jesus is coming back. I'm talking when he come back at his second coming. This is how he's coming. He's not coming by himself. He's coming with power and glory. He's coming with power and glory. We are going to third world war. We are going to third world war. Jesus is coming. And I just want you to know, have they all got their individual teachings wrong? Have they all got it wrong? Because if they're all wrong, you have been misled into believing Jesus not coming in your lifetime, and you could be deadly wrong. So I want everybody who has stayed the duration of this to know that everything that we do at BHF Ministries is only because we don't want to lose no sheep. Jesus said, of all that the Father has given me, I have lost none. I do not want to stand before the judgment throne and God says, you have lost so-and-so. No. Everybody that listen must make it into the kingdom, because we are teaching the way of righteousness and holiness, and the Bible says in that way there is no death. You cannot be lost in that way. So this is what we are doing. We are loving you with truth, and we are loving you in holiness and righteousness. We're not entertaining you. Sorry, there's loads of church all over the place. They'll entertain you. You'll go there. You'll see your way into hell. You'll rejoice your way into hell. But you still get in hell. We're saying, let's go after righteousness and holiness. Because this is the way our Lord walk. And it will be well in the end. It will work out. No matter the trials. I'm not saying it's not going to be trials. I'm not going to say it's not struggles. I can testify their struggle. And Brother Eli can tell you their struggle. And many other Christians can tell us their struggle on the road. But one thing I can say, there is also disappointments. Many times we believe something is going to happen. Now it doesn't happen. Disappointment after disappointment. Trials after trials. And you're wondering, wow. Wow, it doesn't have to be this way. But we keep pressing on because we believe God. And once we keep pressing on and believing God, it always works out in the end. God always comes through. He's always faithful. So many times you might feel as a believer that, wow, is it worth it? I can tell you it is more than worth it. It is more than worth it. No matter disappointment, no matter the hurdles, the joy that's before us is more than worth it. You will never, ever be ashamed if you walk after holiness and righteousness in Christ. Never, never be ashamed. And when you see how God has been good to you in your life, when God show you how many times he has interceded for you, times you did not know, times I did not know, how many times he has saved us during our life, in that day we'll cry because of all the times we were murmuring and complaining while he was saving us. But we are human beings and flesh, and sometimes we are moved by flesh and we don't know the goodness of God in that time. But God is always good, even when we're upset, even when we're downhearted. God is still good. God never change. He changed not. He's just good. He's a good God. So though our mood might sway us one way and our mood might sway us the other way, God is straight. God does move. God does stand firm. And so it is. We place our trust in him. That's why Paul said, I know in whom I have trust. And so we're going to trust him. A long way to go. Lots of troubles ahead. But those who walk with the clean hands and pure heart shall get through this day. Shall get through this day. We shall see the goodness of God. We shall see the goodness he'll do to his people. We shall see it. We shall see it, because his promises is sure, everlasting. His promise is real. It's real. So I just want to encourage you to search the scriptures. And I'm going to be searching, because I want to come back with answers to some of the questions that I have placed on your heart. when people explain things to me, it has to be scripturally sound, not man understanding. So that's why I always try to stick scripturally sound, because do unto others as you like them do unto you. So I always come with scriptures upon scriptures upon scriptures, because the word of God is the sure word. Peter said it's the sure word of God. So we stand on that. But thank you again for joining us. May God cause us to meet next week according to his perfect will. We bless you, and let's bow our heads and pray. We thank everyone. Sorry, we just thank everyone who has given to the ministry and donate. May God continue to bless you, that you may have to share and to bless his kingdom as he bless you. We thank God for all of you. Let's bow our heads and pray now. Righteous Father, the seed that's been sown is a seed of searching. We pray, righteous God, that you'll cause people to search the scripture. Everyone that's eyes is closed and heads is bowed, I pray, righteous God, that you'll cause them to search the scriptures and to understand the time. The end of the game, the end of this sermon is for them to find out the times that they're living in, that they may sharpen up themselves to prepare for what's coming, that they may cast off that which is not right, that they may prepare. When Jacob was coming to worship before you, Father, when he was coming to worship before you, he told his family to cast away the idols and they buried it under a tree, because he was coming to you, Father. He was coming, so he knew he couldn't come with no idols, no image. He was preparing himself to come before you, Father God. And you said you'll come back on a third day. You said it in Exodus. You said, tell the children of Israel to prepare themselves today, tomorrow, because you're coming on the third day. It's a spiritual insight of what's happening in this day. You're coming. And your word to them is to sanctify themselves today, tomorrow, and you will appear on the third day. So the sanctification is what we are working on, Father God. We want the people to sanctify themselves for your coming. We cannot change hearts and minds who don't want to change. Your word is the one that changes people. We just speak it. We know that your word is good. Your word is good. And when it's sown to the hearts that have good grown, it will blossom and will bear fruit. So we know, right, as Father, we just have to trust your word is true, because the things that we seek and the things that we want to do is for your kingdom to grow and for people to see. We want heaven to rejoice. We want people to be saved. We want the family to grow in holiness and righteousness. We want your name upon our foreheads, Father, to show that we are your family. We want the sign that you are God be instilled in us. We want to do everything that pleases you. Every day that you want us to keep, we want to keep it. And everything that you want us to do, we want to do it. But we're asking you to make a way where there seems to be no way. We're asking to open doors where there's ever doors shut. We're asking you to be God in our life with a mighty stretched forth hand. This we ask in the name of our loving Savior. We ask you to bless our Savior from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. We bless him who saved us and laid down his life for us. We bless him who has done all this wonderful work for us. Because of his intercession, we're still here. We bless him that he, Father, still have everyone under my voice, names upon his lips. We thank him for being such a good Savior and a loving Father. We bless you, Father. We bless you for being this loving Father in our lives. And Jesus Christ, our Savior, who stay closer than a brother. We want to be an example of you on earth. So we need you to anoint us more with the spirit of truth, that we may complete the work and the task that you call us. You ordain us to bring forth fruit. You're the one that gives the spirit, the Holy Spirit, because Father put it in your hand to do it. So we ask you to increase the spirit, that we may increase fruitfulness. We ask to be pruned, Father, that we may bear more fruit in Christ. All this we ask in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Yeshua HaMashiach, your only begotten Son. Amen. 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 Everyone, have a wonderful Sabbath day, and may God keep you now and bless you always and cover you from all the works of the enemy. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Eli, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Man of Issachar. Well deliberated message today and sermon. We glorify our Father in heaven, and we always ask that our Lord and Savior Yeshua Mashiach remains in our presence, and we ask that everyone stays steadfast on this journey. It's gonna get turbulent, it's gonna get rocky, it's gonna get rough, but we need to endure and remain on that narrow path. We ask that the Lord bless you in each and every way and your family, and continue letting you lead this ministry for righteousness and holiness. And we thank each and everyone for joining us today. We glorify God for your life, and we ask that if you have not chosen to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it is a good time to do that. And if you are, if there's something that you know that you're doing wrong, I ask that you repent and turn away from it, because the kingdom of God is at hand. Until next time, we all love you here at Beit Saf Ministries. May the good Lord bless you. Amen.